A caring gem that acts the most harmful, an ignorant innocence that is twisted by the cold truth. Their harsh, indirect actions fulfill the dreams of those that they care for. Is this what it means to be human? Humans do the most terrible acts for the most kindest of reasons. Phos is no different. Phosphophyllite's entire character arc teaches us, the audience, the pitfalls of not having self-awareness. Phos is self-absorbed, self-destructive, self-imposing, and self-sacrificial. But the biggest trait that Phos has is their self-confidence, which is not to be mixed with their self-esteem that is always lacking. See, Phos believes that if they actually put proper effort into the work that they wanted to do, they would do a fantastic job. But anytime the going gets a little too tough or bothersome, they backtrack very quickly. This allows them to avoid taking so much pain that they would have to change their way of life. These gems getting hurt is akin to getting a little cut on the skin without feeling any of the pain. It's a mild annoyance, and sure, it takes some time to heal even if it leaves a little scar. It doesn't alter the person in any significant way. Hell, you can even put products on your skin to alleviate the scarring, similar to how Rutil puts the white powder on the gems to hide their unevenness. Phos has gotten to a point after 300 years of life that even the act of breaking down due to their fragility doesn't really bother them, as other gems are weary of Kongo's way of acting within the first chapter itself. We see this lack of urgency in Phos's reaction until it comes into direct opposition to what Phos wants to do, fight. But all we have seen of Phos thus far in the story is that they hide in Kongo's shadow. They are not someone who stands in the front lines properly now or ever. The natural history job is boring, so Phos deflects, but even so, this job is the only thing that keeps them together thousands of years later. It's an observational study where they don't have to experiment, they don't have to put input, they just have to record as they see it, or as close as they can, because Kongo is the one that constructed their eyes. The historian role doesn't mesh with the battle role perfectly. The advice given is pushed off to someone that doesn't stare at the sky at all. Someone completely different from the battle role. Phos doesn't see a loner as their equal. Even though they've been alone without a job and without feeling the satisfaction of contributing to society, which makes Phos on the same level, when they make the promise, they realize the burden it carries. Phos's immortality feeds into their self-denial and creates a cage that just wants to get out, but knows it shouldn't. It causes them to go further than needed, as the one who traps themselves into the night is a perfect scapegoat to self-impose their struggles, as the sincerest thing that Phos says is also the most selfless. Phos, who has never been good at anything and taken probably hundreds of years to get to the point where they are ready to ask Kongo to fight, has even that pipe dream stolen from them. The gem who stays in the leaves that bears their namesake, the Greek word for leaf, Phos, cannot possibly know what it means to be a friend. They have a superiority complex against all other gems because they know that they are capable of more, but have an inferiority complex against those same exact gems because each of them has a role Phos does not. Kongo gave Phos life, but Phos cannot provide for Kongo like the others. Self-sacrifice means denying yourself, and who is better at doing that than humans? Confidence breeds pride. This disconnect between what you feel you are capable of and what you actually produce is something anyone can relate to. I know that I can do more, but I choose not to. It's your own body and mind holding you back from taking the next step out of this gap, with confidence and potential on one side, and success and happiness on the other. The bridge that connects the two is devotion. Buddha says that devotion is the opening that brings the light, the door to enlightenment. Let go of the pain because it's only temporary. And that notion is very powerful. I devoted myself to my studies because I felt it was the one thing that I could do right. There were others in my middle school days that would claim lofty ideals like, oh, I should have just studied harder, I would have done better. And my ignorant self just didn't understand because I had studied harder and I did do better. It was as simple as that. No thinking involved, just pen to the paper and write down all the facts and observations of the world around me and use that same information on the exam. Easy. Straightforward. I think I was happy. Well, maybe it was just the rose-colored tongue speaking. It wasn't until I failed after college that I realized my classmates, my old classmates' sentiment. once you hit that rock bottom, the obsidian of your life, that you recognize the hubris of this devotion or this confidence. I was devoted in the path because I knew I would make money. I was devoted to the studying because I felt smarter than the others. I was devoted in the thought that if I tried just a little bit harder, I could be where I was 4 years ago, when I was happy, when I thought I was happy. I envy my old self, just like Phos does. But just like Phos does, I don't want to go back to those times. And they were colored and tinted in such an extreme way that the reality of how I feel now is different from then, and if I think back on the same moment tomorrow, it will feel different yet again. At some point, the decisions that you make catch up to you, that ignorance is no longer possible. This is what happens to Phos after Antarcticite goes to the moon. Every single step of Antart's arc was a direct result of Phos wanting to change. Because they were usually the first to sleep, Phos does the exact opposite and is the first to wake up. They see the difference between using Kongo as a shield from the world and becoming a shield for Kongo's sake. When they needed to get the work done the most, they were too slow to save anyone. When they needed to show resolve, they were too fast to run away. Antart shares the job instead of imposing it as Phos does the exact opposite of. By instead of sharing the promise with Cinnabar, they insist and force it on them. Phos gives up the moment they realize this winter job is boring, not because it's actually boring, but because they're not an expert at it. Phos is still apparent innocence sways in Antart, who has never worked with another person before. Antart tries to care for this child that is left to them by Kongo because Kongo couldn't take care of them, but Antart is not fit with the right tools. Don't keep an eye on them too long, they lose their arms. Go to fix their arms, their own body doesn't cooperate. Phos' faith in their body betrays them time and time again because they don't really understand what they want. That confidence goes to waste when there is no proper direction for it, and Kongo never gave that to Phos because Phos rejected it every single time. An intrinsic motivation stays with you a lot longer, and you feel more satisfied. Phos doesn't even try to come up with something on their own. That idea of battling gets shattered the moment they are incapable of doing anything with the twins. But they still long for it because they claim they didn't try enough. Oh, and those legs don't move exactly how I want them to. Excuses are the staple to Phos's reactionary decisions. But the one thing that wasn't reactionary, the one thing that they actually take action for out of their own volition, is for their ray of hope, Cinnabar. Phos values Cinnabar's opinion more than anyone else's. Why? Cinnabar is the exact opposite of Phos. They are a better fit for the natural historian role because Cinnabar is so afraid of their mercury hurting others, they tend to pay more attention to their surroundings, which is exactly what a historian needs. It's ironic that the gems that stare too much at the sky think that Cinnabar doesn't, when they clearly do just as much as the battlers, but for a completely self-deprecating reason. The jealousy that Cinnabar feels for Phos because the Lunarians who never come for them show up for this rare green, it's justified, and will be elaborated on a later section as to why. Although in the previous section I stated that Phos is self-indulgent, Phos does have some really redeeming qualities, or else no reader would actually like them. Their request to Cinnabar is genuine. Not the first time, sure, but Cinnabar is definitely in a worse position than Phos, and yet they have found a role no matter how harmful it is to themselves, as long as they found a role that fits within the gem society, which Phos could not. For that, Phos decides they should at least struggle just a little bit less than usual. This is the one and only time that Phos and Cinnabar's visions line up in unison, something that is more fun than Night Patrol. That promise is what cements their investment in each other and also keeps them separated. It's very paradoxical, but Cinnabar would have given up their self-isolation if Phos just asked them a simple question to be a team. An equal, or someone to depend on, instead of Phos taking on the savior complex while having the elevated status of Cinnabar as this gem on a pedestal. This disconnect between Phos and Cinnabar continued to grow, not only because Phos lost their memories, but also mainly because Phos never really tried to understand Cinnabar at all. And as more and more time passed, Cinnabar continued to remember the one thing Phos pushed onto them, while Phos continued to forget and adjust based on their new surroundings. Cinnabar hates the fact that Phos is the only one who tries to help their situation because Cinnabar knows it will never happen. But they're okay waiting around because Cinnabar doesn't believe that they can help themselves. Phos is no different in this regard, as they do go try to help other people, just not with the same attitude as Cinnabar. Cinnabar blames themselves for others' failures, especially Phos's, because they know that Phos only gets into these situations because they want to save Cinnabar. But it's never the other way around. Cinnabar doesn't save Phos, even if Phos believes that to be the case. Like with the sea, as Cinnabar just waits helplessly, and Phos happens to wash up on the shore on their own. Phos claims that next time, it will be their turn to return an empty favor. But the legs that they receive are only good to run away from their problems. When springtime comes around, Phos is happy that Cinnabar hasn't changed, but that couldn't be further from the truth that Cinnabar has changed, and it's because of Phos. Cinnabar, instead of looking up at the sky for salvation, they're waiting for Phos on the ground just a tad bit longer. Phos's read on Cinnabar is terrible, and it continues to deviate drastically, while Cinnabar's read on Phos is spot on, because the moment Phos forgets the fun part of the promise, Cinnabar knows they don't have to feel guilty when Phos gets injured, because they're not really doing it for Cinnabar anymore. The standards for the goal has shifted slightly, but just enough to change the goal completely. It's interesting how this goalpost has moved even more to the point where Cinnabar actually gets frustrated. After the Shiro incident, Cinnabar says that they are still making up their mind, but it's actually in response to should they keep believing on Phos or not. So much so that Cinnabar finally calls Phos's BS out by stating where the fun part went, and Phos just stops trying to fake remember at this point. And because of this, Cinnabar refuses to continue forward until Phos lays it all out with every contingency thought of. Because if Phos keeps forgetting things, even the plan or the reasoning for that plan become invalid to Cinnabar, who thinks way too much about themselves and about the impact they have on others. Ghost pairing up with them in the same chapter shows exactly why Cinnabar and Phos would fail together. Because Cinnabar expects the same level of attention and reasoning, while Phos is just trying to accomplish this with holes in their knowledge, leading to the worst possible outcomes. Right before the moon, Phos goes up to the one they want to hear from the most, but only to see them, because they don't actually want advice. Phos's mind can come to the same reasonings as Cinnabar. The only difference is that Phos is willing to try something that isn't possible because what is there to lose? Phos's morality, which they learn from Cinnabar by getting scraped and wanting to never forget those memories again, spurs this type of behavior. Cinnabar's venom is literally the thing that kills everything around them except their own body. It's interesting to note that the actual compound Cinnabar on its own is not dangerous, and the mercury inside of it is not even the worst version of mercury that is possible. As long as the compound is not heated up, the mercury inside of it won't vaporize and cause harm, as it is locked in by the sulfide in the crystal. Only elemental mercury is found inside Cinnabar, while the other two versions, inorganic and organic mercury, methyl mercury, are 1,000 times more lethal. This is fascinating because why then is Cinnabar represented in Houseki no Kuni as their liquid appears in two ways? Little balls that seem to float around them, used as a form of light, and it ruptures out of their body when their emotions are riled up, potentially due to the energy or heat released from the inclusions, causing this kind of effect, as they are one of two gems that can cry, and both don't seem to have control over it at all. This morality, or should I say mortality, puts a timer on Cinnabar, but not in the same way as Phos, because instead, Cinnabar continues to kill the emotions they feel for Phos as the time progresses. They justify the self-harm that Phos inflicts as Phos would have done this anyways, even without the promise, because Phos doesn't remember the origin to begin with, and having this sort of selfishness at the end of the day. This was the reason of building up the anticipation for Cinnabar to toss it all away at every encounter by the time Phos gets back in Chapter 61. As Houseki no Suffering points out, even after everything, the prior visit where Cinnabar tells him not to go after getting hurt and still ends up wishing them to take care of themselves, because Cinnabar has already thought of the uncertainties that comes with going up to the moon. This miscommunication was bound to reach its tipping point. What actually causes Cinnabar to say no is in fact two intertwined reasons. One is that they aren't special anymore in Phos's eyes, as the moment Phos mentions the other gems in the plan to go to the moon, it throws Cinnabar off. What use is there for Cinnabar if they don't feel like they are the specific one for the job? And then the second reason is if so many leave, who will be there for Kongo and the others that stay? That would become the motivation for Cinnabar's loyalty to the Earth gems. Phos continues to misunderstand Cinnabar's situation because it's never the mercury itself that was the problem. Yes, the mercury is what makes them isolate themselves in the first place, but if they cared, solutions like what obsidian helps make for them With the winter sleeping would have happened much, much sooner, and Cinnabar would not have had to rely on Phos's impotence. Even Kongo misunderstands, similar to how Alexei, even on the moon, never underwent the surgery to change the constitution of their eyes. It's never a matter of treating the symptoms of the part of body that doesn't work the way that you want it to work. It's more important to just adjust your life to fit those restrictions, because that is what makes you and your struggles uniquely you. Kongo can't understand this because they aren't human to begin with. Kongo's personality switches completely 180 before and after the Lunarian transformation that removes all of his restrictions, and that showcases why they never understood Cinnabar perfectly. Chapter 92 is one of my favorite chapters of the series because it is the conclusion of the promise that was established for Phos's premise as their main desire. The small amount of dialogue really packs the punch as Cinnabar tries to remain as calm and collected, while Phos agitates and tries to mess with them. However, in the spread that follows, we see how weak Cinnabar's stance looks, on top of how sharp and repulsive Phos's gold is reacting against Cinnabar's mercury. It's cool that the mercury doesn't actually do much to the gold. In a study of elemental mercury vapor interactions on gold nanorods, there wasn't any measurable changes to the gold, even with the saturated amounts of mercury vapor on them, and the only thing was that the light resonance shifted towards the blue, more of a color that is deeply associated with Phos in the second half of the story anyways. Actually, mercury received the name hydrofuran, meaning watery silver in the Greek language, because just like water, mercury is a great solvent for most metals, and due to mercury's low boiling point, it is used in extracting gold from ore since at least the Roman times, in a process of amalgamation and distillation. Gold actually dissolves mercury like salt dissolves in water, and this mixture, when it's boiled to get the mercury out, retains a high level of gold purity. Phos's tiny arm shows the amalgamation at work, but shows the potency of the mix as Phos is made of. Phos's retort of being a pathetic 2 is used by Cinnabar to counter Phos's threats. Visually, when Phos uses a 3-pronged attack symbolizing their 3 hardness, followed by a 2-pronged attack to show the effectiveness of that number by breaking off parts of Cinnabar's limbs. This is followed by a repeat of Cinnabar's first appearance in the story, where they form mercury clones to attack and coat the Lunarians, but Phos just kinda cuts them down like the gems normally do to the Lunarians by chopping their heads off. However, Cinnabar's final double fake is effective in breaking through Phos's head. However, the gold lattice structure that works on the outside of Phos's body forms a neural network that functions on its own and works as an inclusion system to retain their function, even when their physical shape is so deformed, because Phos doesn't even know what their body used to look like anymore, which is further emphasized by the next chapter, as they don't even know what their promise was. Phos doesn't even care to ask about it anymore. They only fixate on one thing, Kongo's prayer, as that goal will fix everything else in time, so it takes real priority in all of Phos's brain power. This mercury was just a mild obstacle and annoyance, which is represented by the blockage of the left eye by Cinnabar's mercury, which obstructs Phos's left side and Cinnabar's right side, showing that who really had the happiness all along? It was Cinnabar.
Phos. 本当はね、非常な才気と戦闘力を持ちながら何もかもダメにしてしまう彼を私たちは持て余し。
Even with the very minimal dialogue, Ichikawa uses this amazing paneling to tell us the conflicting feelings of these gems who've gone through multiple lifetimes worth of years struggling to understand each other. This channel is still not sponsored in any sort of way, and videos still require money to produce. And the easiest way that you, the viewer, can support is just by watching my videos. And if you haven't subscribed yet, and I know that many of you aren't, we are trying to get to 10,000 sufferers strong so that we can be by Phos's side as the series reaches its last stretch. So let's proceed with gold is a mean of wealth, but also an expression of generosity. Its various practical uses in aerospace for technology that requires a super resilient conductor to get the job done, or perfect for fillings, crowns, and bridges for orthodontic applications in dentistry, to fill the tops of the holes in the body, or for more medical usage of salts to alleviate conditions of tuberculosis, or even help with this condition called lagophthalmos, which is a person's inability to close their eyes. By planting a small amount of gold in the upper eyelid, it helps the eye actually blinking. Even done a publication in college that tested nanoporous gold and platinum electrodes on the efficacy to read the redox or electricity run through stored red blood cells, and you can find that paper in the references of the description in this video. Even though around 78% of the total gold mined each year is made into jewelry due to its malleability and obviously its shiny look, I mean, people love the look of gold, these various uses tells us just how versatile gold is. This openness of the material and the openness of the mind is generosity. Whatever we can do and are currently doing must be done with joy and appreciation. If you aren't greedy or holding back, these practices, as Buddhism states, this compassion that is offered by doing anything you can according to the given resources and abilities that you have now, that is known as generosity. Phos accomplishes this to some degree, as everything they do has this touch of generosity, but they do hold back when Pat tells them to, but then are open about their mind immediately afterwards, and both approaches don't really get them the answers that they want. What must be done then? Is generosity enough to seek anything that is attainable? Phos's acquisition of gold was not generous. They knew their arms were weak, and that their legs, which aren't really theirs anymore, had gotten strong. But the burden of that new responsibility of having speed is too much to bear, and the weight of their worries is too unbalanced in the lower half of their body. So the gold works as a perfect physical representation of that pain of loss due to another's generosity of self-sacrifice that Phos models heavily after in ant art. Gold, as stated, is a perfect conductor for Phos's mental state through the actions that they seek and the inclusions that reside in that liquid amalgamation. Whatever Phos wants, their gold will respond, just not perfectly. Why does Phos lose connection with the gold alloy at pivotal moments of the series? As stated in the crystal section, Phos is the type of gem that, when the going gets tough or when their ambition supersedes their skills, Phos will revert back to rejecting or underhandling the task at hand, first as a defense mechanism to prevent further trauma, whether physical or mental. The second the gold alloy is put on, it encases them because their speed is no longer available, so defense in an outward structure is the second best option. But gold is usually very pliable, so why is this cube such a hard thing for ant art to break open? Because Phos's gold is an alloy with platinum. The standard split for a gold-platinum mix is 10% gold and 90% platinum. Although this mix has been used for a really long time, in 2018 a new version of this mix with the same composition split is 100 times more durable than high-strength steel, making it the first alloy in the same stature or class as diamond or sapphire, nature's most wear-resistant materials. Metal coatings in general are usually extremely expensive as a protective layer, and they themselves do eventually wear down, but this new ultra-lasting coating could save $100 million a year in the electronics industry alone. Of course, our series originates prior by 6 years, but that doesn't mean the previous versions of this alloy weren't durable at all, and still holds its ground. Phos's alloy allows the ambition of this unrealistically optimistic gem to expand in ways unimaginable. As cinnabars, mercury is very unstable due to emotional distressors that make it hard to control, Phos's gold-platinum alloy should be stable and provide a rock-solid base to accomplish their goals. However, it's the mental instability of Phos that is expressed through this alloy structure that negates its advantages. Phos wants to call out to ant art to scream, but the alloy knows that it would just alert the Lunarians to Phos's presence. They're self-serving. That's the end of it. Phos wants these arms to be useful, but by the time they get to taking action, the alloy is so heavy that the burden is lost on those legs that move so fast in the beginning that really could have saved ant art. Regretting their past actions after winter causes the internal gold alloy to become uncooperative to Phos's external intentions. Phos utters one line, "Back me up, okay?" to Ghost, and the next panel we see the Ghost stirring up some trouble because Phos reminisces of the time, not so recently, where they did withhold backing up Ghost to see what Kongo does. It's Kongo and now Phos' secret to keep hidden and stored away, but the goal doesn't resonate with that notion, and coupled with the failure to help Cinnabar's situation thus far since the start of the story, all compounds to Gold unable to respond fast enough to the changes of the Lunarian attack because their inclusions are working in overtime thinking of their own prior worries. Phos overreacts and their Gold encloses Cairngorm, which is what they believe they should have done to Antart and trap them in the same cube that they themselves were stuck in safety. The chapter title for chapter 39 is Self-Admonition, and like the definition, the Gold is criticizing Phos' weakness and helplessness by inflicting self-harm, ripping themselves in the same fashion the Lunarians did to Antart. Their crying, just like Cinnabar, is due to their helplessness and generosity of others to their loner selves. When Phos gets rebuilt by Kongo in chapter 79, their Gold leaks everywhere, and it seems like even after all this time, this Gold, even a small amount of it, can't really cure Phos' lagophthalmos around the moon eye because of how foreign the moon eye is. It can never be closed. Their Gold is responding to leaving everything, even their entire being, and the body and their regrets to Kongo to fix, but the Gold cannot accept that. Then this will amount to the answer they want because it would just be too plain easy. While Phos tries to put back the gems they stomped on to complete their given task, old memories fold in so much that even the toxic and thick mercury that covers the eye that should give happiness cannot prevent the fall of their predecessors. Humans, nothing can shield you from the past no matter how much of a helping hand, or a sympathetic hand, in this case, an eye, is given. The lattice structure that we talked about in the previous section about chapter 92 is extremely fascinating as it forms a sort of neural network that binds together the pieces of Phos externally, which works so well because Ghost is that conductor, just like the nerves use electricity to transport information, and probably how the inclusions do it as well. But the external fillings of cracks is very reminiscent of the art form of Kintsugi, which both terms apply to our dear Phos. The Gold repairs the cracks that are formed in their body and joins pieces of Phos and other things that get thrown in together to keep it functioning. It follows the philosophy that was brought up in the sea early on in the story, that Kongo teaches the gems to take care of things and not to throw them away, similar to the Buddhist term Motiani. The feeling of regret when something is wasted. Phos internalizes this lesson with their own body once the Gold is added because it will mend just like Kintsugi does when incorporating the damage of the broken item into the aesthetic of the restored said item, usually with gold, silver, or platinum to make it a part of the object's history. Imperfections are gifts to be worked with, not shames to be hidden. The white powder cannot confine the morphology of gold, and the alloy makes full use of this by rejecting the suppression of cracks, just like the temple or the school the gems live in, that have plenty of exposed damage that never seems to get fully repaired throughout the years, to show that this society is centered around Kongo, which will stand the test of time. While the temple gets completely destroyed during the transitional period when the new divine Phos takes ownership. This unevenness of the body is something that I very closely understand in regards to stretch marks as I started getting at the beginning of college. I was ashamed of having them, even though when they first started, the first stretch was around the chest to bicep region. It was due to me actually putting on proper amounts of muscle, mix of good bulking, eating chicken teriyaki from Panda Express every night, and lifting regularly. The better I got with my lifts, the more this bright red, and sometimes painful to the touch, marks would appear. It felt like they were searing into my shoulders, and I hated them. I hated the look of them. So much so that I subconsciously started lifting less and less, and by the time it was summer, after the first year ended, I just stopped entirely working out. I knew that everyone gets these kinds of stretch marks, and it's perfectly normal, but it made me feel repulsed by my own skin. The creams didn't really help, as the marks would set in as white really fast instead of the bright red in no time. And since the second year and the stress of school, I lost all the muscles I built and subsequently gained fat fast. which caused the stretch marks that were previously a sign of progress for my body, that I should have cherished, turned into a constant reminder of my lack of desire to want to better myself, as these newer marks spread faster and quicker than ever before. It's almost like my body punished me for giving up on itself, and it rejected my own intentions of wanting to hide them. Years have gone by since, and I'm on the process of getting those gains back and hopefully losing the burdens of my regrets throughout the past 4 years, and I welcome any and all new battle scars onto my skin because it is only mine to see and admire. This kintsugi approach makes most of what already was, and incorporates the experiences that you've had and the person that you are, and validates them, and gives you a reason, a desire to exist, because you are you. No one else can have this kind of body. Yes, you may occasionally chip and break and need repairs, but the world is abundant, and there will always be something to mend these pieces that were never perfect to begin with. The only thing that we can do is make these flaws into our greatest strengths. Lapis is associated with the sky because of the big amount of azure present in this very complex gem composition, which works perfectly for our gem because their head is always up in the clouds, thinking of so many different possibilities and outcomes for the information that they gather. Lapis's ability in any situation is to see what's going on, assess it, and figure out the best course of action to further stroke the curiosity that fuels Lapis's desire, and it is just brilliant because it ties so well with the gemstone themselves, as Lapis is associated with strength, courage, royalty, wisdom, intellect, and truth, all things seen or expressed by Phos or Lapis at one point. Lapis's strength is in the middle of the pack at exactly 5 for the most scale, but this is still stronger than Phos. Ghost and Cairngorm worship Lapis because of their perfection, and Lapis bestows heaps of wisdom for Phos in the hunt for the truth. We only learn about Lapis through others. Even Dreamscape Lapis is not their real self, but a memory or a set of instructions. The library only has books that very few read constantly, like Rutil or Alexei. Outside of that, no other gems seem to really have expressed interest within our time frame of the story. This could be that the fact that the gems have lived so long, they probably have read these books at some point, and the inclusions have just dumped out that useless information after hundreds and hundreds of years. So Lapis, who's the closest to the books, will find other ways to kill time, and it seems like the Lunarians are the most interesting beings, as they're rarer to find on Earth than the gems, so it's a logical step to get invested in why they come for these gems. Organization is key. Lapis probably figured out that Congo cannot provide all the information they would find. However, the big difference between that and now with Phos is that the Lunarians never gave so many different types of sunspots, as they never used items that belonged to Congo's past until recently when the moon technology was developed to another level. The Lunarians probably didn't give a chance to challenge Lapis enough. If they did, they would have just flat out told Phos to go up to the moon and not had to sprinkle these hints down. However, without the snails, Phos wouldn't have known about the humans, and without a reintroduction to the snail, all the pieces wouldn't have been placed to think of the moon as the next destination. I'll talk about the snails in a later section, but they are really vital to the story, if you think about it just a little bit. So while thinking too much on the job like they do, and I'm sure they also heard the sounds of the Lunarians but never had the desire to talk to them, Phos bridges the gap of knowledge and potential and ties into wanting to learn more about their enemy that Lapis got caught with. If more than just Lapis's head was taken up, I could believe that they actually wanted to go to the moon themselves. But since it's only the head, it feels like, really, how Lapis defines it, they really just got careless. Also, the dirty little secret that Lapis probably hid from Ghost, that Ghost mentions, was probably in fact that none of the pieces that resided in the center were usable, because Cairngorm states that fact with such certainty that it didn't originate from Ghost's thoughts. Lapis likes influencing others around them and gives little hints that other gems that don't have such strong critical thinking could eventually follow and get to the approach that they want, and it's really similar to how Enma manipulates Phos. Withholding information to mock Congo's inability to tell the full truth while still commanding similar respect is pretty commendable. Logical reasoning is predictable. Lapis was primed for this, as their natural abilities allows for higher levels of base information collection. Ancient Egyptians used powdered lapis as eyeshadow to improve eyesight, something that is taken way more literally by giving Phos Lapis's actual eyes. The complexity of the gem itself may allow for light refraction to happen across so many of these parts, and even pyrite or fool's gold cannot trick the analytical mind. And it's interesting as this big contrast to Phos, who is also a really complex gem, but they became a complex gem while Lapis existed as a complex gem. That is the division between a natural gem like Lapis and Phos, similar to how there's this stark difference between Cinnabar, who has the aqueous solution built into their body, compared to Phos, who that gets added on after the fact. A librarian's role is to catalog and maintain the collection, as well as add new entries into the system over time. This requires a high level of reading comprehension, and especially with the close proximity to the books, there's this familiarity with the words and the flow in which they are connected together in an audio-visual level that allows Lapis to have such a vast knowledge base. This wider breadth of words gives more options to explore, specifically in terms of inferences. And this concept in inference, making an assumption about future events based on prior knowledge, is the core of what gets Phos up to the moon. Because without that word, without inferences, Phos would not have made it. Because they only relied on prior information but could not make the jump to the next level. They saw gaps, but they couldn't fill it. Inferences makes those holes filled. The pyrite that is dominant in the eyebrow region of Lapis's head, where the frontal lobe sits, proves to be more than just a really dope character design. This material is used for abundance, confidence, and protection, all things that Lapis probably assumed they had, although all of them were actually used for Phos instead. Phos had thousands of years to get their task completed, boundless confidence, and a multifaceted protection with a sturdier master in Congo and a revolving set of gems who fought for Phos one reason or another. But the pyrite is a symbol of the fake piece of gold, something that is just an imitation of the real thing that Phos ends up possessing, because no other gem even dared to test the gold platinum alloy because it's just too heavy to hold. Phos just does not care. It gets mistaken, and a lot of Phos' actions get mistaken as Lapis by others due to Lapis' influence. Pyrite burns away the entropy of Phos' chaotic inclusions and sets the facts straight. Things that seem to be lost to time were actually not handled properly for proper memory retention. Even something lost can be reminded and restored, similar to how our mind continues to modify and alter memories each time we choose to visit or choose not to visit them. My memories are pretty trash, and that's why I keep documentations of my thoughts as much as possible about anime and manga in the forms of YouTube videos, in tweets, on AnyList, anything and everywhere. But even still, I rewatch to get a full retrospective anytime I need to do that. But of course, that changes the impression of that coveted first watch. The first set of eyes that pass through and experience the media, although it's never unbiased, just like with the Phos or with the gems, because it's molded by Congo's hand that these eyes look through the world. I do hope to continue to document that in the same way, because it is vital to the way that I process things. Writing things down helps. My organization has definitely gone to the crapper as of this late past few years, and I'm craving this sort of physicality. So what I've been doing so far, especially with the construction of this video, because there's so many moving parts that needed to be managed for consistency that is outside of my control. This little cardstock, 8x11 with post-it notes, that's it, and it compartmentalizes things similar to how the bubbles in Lapis's dream coat the real details. You just gotta pull back the layers to find the really good stuff. Enma is a strategist and manipulates everything and everyone to what seems to be his goal of doing anything he can for the lowest rungs of human society that could not be prayed away. Did Enma feel bad for these Lunarians, similar to how Phos felt bad for Cinnabar's position at the beginning of the story? Was that just their nature to care, or maybe to superimpose their own worries onto those that they deem lower than them, for the concept of salvation? how did Enma plot everything out to recreate a human so well, which ended up using Phos as the framework for this master plan? Well, Phos was clearly not the only option and just happened to be the most fruitful, since Enma doesn't actually have direct control over other Lunarians because they will move and attack however they want to when their commander Enma gives them a basic order. For example, they will put Phos back together when they first arrived on the moon according to Enma's orders, sure, but something like working overtime or like overnight is fought against with the usage of unions. Like, these Lunarians have their own individualistic desires, and that doesn't, at the end of the day, trump what Enma wants. The key of Enma moving along his plans the way that he does is due to sunspots, and the fact that the Lunarians can actually spy on the gems for as long as possible until they really want to appear. This is the basis of how the Lunarians actually can track the gems' activities. This explains the disappearing sunspots, which is a chapter that a lot of people might have skipped if they jumped straight into post-anime content, instead of reading from the beginning after the anime ends. Even the threat of a disappearing spot makes the gems weary or change their way of approach for future interactions. Like I was stating earlier, Lapis would have been a better betrayer for Phos because they think just like Enma and use gems as pieces on a board to get the answers that they want. But the lack of real information, especially in regards to the other parts of what it means to be human, were never given to Lapis, as being too smart might let Lapis catch on to a lot of the half-truths that Enma speaks. Cinnabar's jealousy is fueled because of Enma. They were waiting for Phos to get a job or get somewhere where the Lunarians could threaten to take them, or actually take them. Even if Enma can't control everything beat for beat, he does know when to plan losses and encourage doubt to fester. Seeing Phos move from the central point of the temple to the edge of the island was more than enough reason to take action. For the Lunarians to strike near the end of the day, which is not really a time that they operate anyways, and Cinnabar happens to be in that spot to take action. Phos lives another day, but Enma recognizes that this boredom-filled gem of 300 years has made some change, so might as well foster that by sending a snail down. Whether he knew that the snail and Phos would be able to communicate is irrelevant, because the real reason was to get Phos to feel the taste of what betrayal is. Phos also learns a vital lesson of the concept of death, which is later internalized chapters past, but this is a happy side effect of the snail. Phos losing their arms is a happy coincidence as well. We don't know if there was real communication between the ice floes and Lunarians, but what is important is that when this incident happened, the Lunarians were waiting at the shore until Antart and Phos would get there, and the instructions probably for the mission is along the lines of grab the gems. And since no gem ever attached gold platinum to them, the Lunarians on the job just never really looked to see what that gold cube in the snow was. Enma further reinforces this calculated attack by using imitation Antark when Phos goes up to the moon to show exactly what he did to Antark. Especially with the fact that Enma knew that Antark could not be reformed because of the level of their hardness, this was set up for the failure in Phos' moon journey and put right in Phos' face. They have to experience it. They have to get attached to it. Enma has a way of reinforcing that trauma again and again and again. The remnants of Lapis gave Enma an idea of what to do because the Lunarians obviously keep track of which pieces are left that have inclusions back on Earth. The reason why Enma takes Phos' head is for a simple reason. They were jealous of the closeness with Cairngorm, and that Lapis' head could have had that logical reasoning that Enma wanted to instill into Phos. By giving Phos mortality with Cinnabar, respect for others with the snails, generosity with gold, inferences with Lapis, and finally wisdom with Congo, they could really feel whole. As all the other attempts are just imitations of as the desires in the lab do not create free will, and they probably never could have a child, because does Enma even want to continue in this world to begin with? Where does this lead us with Phos? Their emotions and feelings are fabricated by Enma. They only talk to them when they need something. They plant the idea of a savior into Phos, and this causes future dissonance in Phos to throw away both the Lunarian and the Lustrious lifestyle because they don't see themselves fitting in it. And the snails are tossed aside as well because Phos is filled with guilt, as Phos can make them take their lives just because some part of body that Phos acquired that is useless to Phos now. Enma lies to these gems stating that everyone attacked Phos, where Euclid and Jade might not have. But Phos was never alone. They were just led to believe that they were, by quarantining the Earth to keep Phos stable. Phos didn't really want happiness, but was led to believe that Enma was seeking that sort of eye from Congo when that was clearly not the case. Phos doesn't want to go to nothingness, but that's the only thing left that they are led to think. From Congo, from Doctor, from Enma, from themselves, Phos doesn't have anything more to chase after. This video has been haunting me for a while because of the premise and the need to come out with something Phos related for the past almost 2 years now. But who is this video really for? Someone as egotistical as myself. All YouTubers are egotistical. Relying on others to satisfy you, the viewer. Is that really what this is all about? The analysis is probably alright, but what is the essence? What is my purpose for this video if it is just a retrospective? Why do I love Phos so much as a character? I hope even a sliver of these questions have already been answered with the help of these amazing editors thus far, but from now on until the end of the video, it'll be done by me, myself, and I. So why am I going out of my way to break the flow other than to, you know, get rid of your expectations and highlight the theme of this section, betrayal? Every time that I mention snails or agate, it's always been in reference to the concept of running away. When Pad preaches the idea of treading carefully, it fits well with his philosophy and even matches with Phos's own disposition of running away, as their inclusions run away from the cold, brittle body because their ambition is in direct conflict with the limitations of Phosphophyllite as a gem. When they are supposed to run to get help with the twins, they were unable to because it was more running to than running away from responsibility. And a similar disconnect to when the gold stops working for Phos. Yellow Diamond is a prime example of what it means to run away so much so that you become incapacitated by the future, trying to remember the past. Running away is a slippery slope to betrayal. The snails are the closest to what it means to be human, supposedly, and Phos learned some very important lessons with their time together. Ventrocasis's introduction in chapter 4, titled Cochlea, because Phos learns to use a sense that is more than just sight. Since touch, taste, and smell are completely diminished in a gem body, as there aren't any nerves to indicate change in feeling physicality that we know of. They don't really need to eat, although they did start doing so after the moon, maybe taking on a more Lunarian trait, and never needed to smell anything, because, I mean, the reason why we smell is to avoid toxicity. Even sound is pretty much useless except for basic communication of the language that is derived from Congo himself, but Phos's intimate yet accidental language acquisition of conversing with a being that isn't a Lustrious breeds this new dimension, as this form of communication is the reason that Phos tries to converse with the Lunarians when no other gem tried beforehand. Because of the interactions with Ventrocasis, even if buried under layers upon layers of cracks, still yielded this new trait for Phos. Death is a pretty common occurrence to the snails as something, and I'm gonna keep referring them to the snails, by the way. I'm not even gonna try to butcher Admiral or whatever. Death is a common occurrence to the snails, and something that is stated to be so foreign to the gems, but was it really? Mercury causes lasting damage to the gems' memories, which is their entire being. Once that mercury touches even a single spot, those inclusions are apparently lost forever because the sunlight cannot hit it. Even Cairngorm acknowledges that Lapis is never coming back when they first got taken up. All these gems that have lost a partner understand the definition of death that Ventrocasis gives to Phos. It only seemed odd to Phos at the time because they had never lost a partner before, and this spirals into Phos losing the second most partners next to Yellow, and we all know how they ended up. Remember that the core of this video is that Phos was human all along, and it's the idea of self-awareness and not letting your environment really take control of your being that is the vital point of being alive. These concepts are from dregs of ancient beings, but it's not so ancient when they're reinforced and become standardized in a society by Congo. A different lens on death will be explored by a separate series next month on Halloween for anyone who is interested. Anyways, betrayal. My tangents have gone on long enough, so let's dig into it. The effects of betrayal on the body include shock, loss and grief, damaged self-esteem, self-doubting, anger, and anxiety. When this first happens to Phos because of Ventrocasis, focuses. It's the shock that they feel because Phos had a certain mental image of the snail, and it turned into a being that looked really similar to Phos in the sea. This is a betrayal of sight. Ventrocasis betrays their own retelling of the significance of their form as this weave of tapestry, but it doesn't really get carried across as well as maybe Phos, because if they kept their inclusions intact, they would remember way better than Ventrocasis does. So that's a betrayal of knowledge. This urge to fight, that is something that Phos has been preaching since the very beginning of the story, is something that they actually themselves claim to Ventrocasis that they don't need to do. That's a thing that the humans do. This is a betrayal of ideals. When the Lunarians turned to Ventrocasis because Phos wasn't enough, it was a betrayal upon betrayals. However, the biggest betrayal was actually Phos, as they were okay with all of this. They didn't show any of the signs of betrayal when it really came down to it. This sets the foundation for the failure of Phos's plan to betray Congo, because just like Phos, Congo would not care or react in a way that Phos wants, just as Ventrocasis expected Phos to get angry after all was said and done in the sea. The memories of the time with the snail are interesting because it is a point of the story that Phos needs to forget about humans, because if Phos remembered about the humans, the plot would progress exceedingly fast, and as Enma states, they need to go through the hurdles to actually get and really feel betrayal and pain. Humans do nothing good, as when Phos even utters a word of it, Congo, who used to only be seen breaking things out of the way that he was, you know, he's just clumsy, he's indestructible, so he breaks things, he goes out of his way to break the table, which runs counter to the lesson that Phos was actually preaching to Ventrocasis of taking good care of things. Congo themselves was never really taken care of properly by these humans that he inherited all this wisdom from. The memory of these humans for Phos is actually interesting because it points to how inclusions are stored. If these gems had a memory palace type, or if they actually thought about how they thought about their memories, it would be rearranged differently. When pieces are broken and put back together, it jumbles and mixes up the memories the inclusions hold, as well as the connections that were previously tethered were cut and have to be realigned. Hence, Phos, with their weak constitution that breaks from a simple shout, has such a poor memory base to begin with, on top of just filtering out all of the world's noises because it's too much of a burden to handle, and frankly they don't care about it because they think it's boring. But something like the five-letter word human is so significant that even if Phos takes on so many new parts and changes, the snail in Lapis's dreamscape is rock solid and perfect. Even, you know, isolated sure, but always ever present. Lapis's dream also shows us that gold is deeply woven in that fine silk tapestry to tie together the connections that this same said gold pushes out and breaks apart with every single step that Phos takes in their journey. Speaking of the gold, when platinum interacts with snails in a young age, they are unable to form external shells, a neat parallel that Phos had when they were in the cracks of Ventrocasis themselves. And Phos not really is the reason why these snails go extinct almost, but Phos almost had the chance to kill them all off entirely. So what is agite even? One form of it is Turritella agite, which is a brown colored translucent stone made of fossilized snails, and actually only found in Wyoming in the United States. The transformation of snail to fossil or a state like a gem of the Lustrious takes millions and millions of years, and these particular snails, or the shells of these snails, took some 46 to 51 million years. These snails got unlucky and got deposited in shallow lakes covered by sea sediments, which becomes what the agite is now. Also, what is interesting about this particular agite is that it was originally mistakenly identified as a member of a marine genus, the name Turritella, even though the shell is actually from an extinct freshwater Amelia variant snail. But it was too much of a hassle apparently to change the name, that Turritella stuck around, almost pretty reminiscent of that knowledge of weaving or whatever Ventrocasis was preaching. That this misunderstanding of misappropriation is what is extrapolated onto Phos when they meet with the future king that gives him the idea to go up to the moon. Lapis is half sneaky and half unlucky, but more of a straightforward and direct path should give best results in theory. The mixing of the new king with the agite from Phos is similar to the mix of agite with Phos, suggesting that it wasn't just Phos that holds more than one race on their person. The Lunarian transformation further reinforces that, as turning everyone into a Lunarian, the furthest thing, the closest thing to a human, shows how mobile these states of being are: solid, liquid, gas. The snails technically form all three with their liquid body, solid shell that is created from their food, and gas, which is from the excretion of that same said food. What's to say that the snails are not humans themselves? The snails and Lunarians aren't so different, as both end up segregating their society. In the lowest rungs, the prisoners were treated the most inhumane, while the Lustrious were flipped around because everyone should have been an equal, as the inhumane, as in not human one, is their leader itself. Now jumping to the betrayal phase of Phos's life, the time where they were calculating and manipulative, and exactly what Lapis was really good at doing, but with the drive that Phos had always had. After the moon didn't turn out to be anything like it should have, Phos should have questioned their own plan because it was filled with holes. Enma didn't even care that Phos was going to try this plan out or not, because it doesn't actually benefit Enma in any way. This was just a side effect of their interactions with Woodwentrochesis, and the real reason, whether it was betrayal or some other feeling, was to create a new feeling inside of Phos. Phos needed to feel like they didn't deserve to keep going on, and something that any human feels during their lifetime, that insecurity is fostered in a wrong environment, would almost force someone to want to give up on everything, and it's not the same thing as running away, as that form of giving up is still taking an action in favor of one's own self. Longing for their own disappearance, the way that Phos ended up wanting, was because of everything that they tried to do would never amount to a real tangible result, and that was what Enma was looking for. And that's the thread from betrayal to this feeling, is what Enma claims made Phos human. The burden that was put onto Phos, as there are no kings of the snails on the moon, as Phos was used to make a decision that was so easy for the Lunarians. Phos is human because they see others as equal to them, even if the other person's form is completely different, and has a sort of guilt because taking a life is different from wanting to die, which is the secondary lesson that Enma was trying to teach Phos. The Lunarians have taken the lives of snails many times, and seeing their deaths in such a short lifespan, or grinding up the Lustrious so much that they no longer exist as an entity, shows how callous you can be if given enough repetition, and this is modeled by Phos with their grinding of their own gems by their own feet in the invasion arc. But that is just a part of what it means to be alive, apparently. But a human being is human from the moment they are born, and Phos is inherently human from the moment they are born. Infants are shaped by their parents and mimic the ideologies of those around them, and other animals have more stronger forms of imprinting, so it's perfectly normal to be influenced by someone else at a very young age. Even still, there is enough individuality in these gems due to their innate structures, and no matter how much they love and want to be just like their master, Congo. That comparison, those types of restrictions, these forms of expressions are what makes these gems human, unlike the machine that is Congo. Carnelian is this brownish red mineral that's also called the Arda stone, apparently. It has a lot of history behind it, as the Egyptians, yep, those guys again, like with Lapis, but here they were used to shed the old and embrace the fiery energy of the new. It stimulates passion. The Middle Ages used this stone of alchemy. It seemed to have a protective fire, and it brought out the longevity of life and the fighting spirit, which is something unique to mankind. The name Carnelian itself is from the Latin word meaning flesh, as a reminder that we are flesh and blood. And that makes us us. But carnelian also has a lot of quartz, like the school was made of. It even has a hexagonal crystal system. I think you know where we're going with this. Another interpretation of carnelian is adamantine, which we know is what Congo is made of. So where is the red? Why is it not pad or cinnabar or alexi? Well, pad is a sleepy gem, and well, they didn't really have even a single line of dialogue in chapter 96, so they aren't too relevant at this moment, especially since they turned into Lunarian. Cinnabar I've already assigned to silver, as mercury has that silver composition, and alexi is one of the only gems that doesn't undergo the change where they had the chance to turn red, especially on the moon, so they're out of the picture as well. The doctor with her red blood that has gone through Congo at least once, with the eye that is supposed to bring happiness and is the reason for the transition from human to supposed god in Phos, is that last treasure of Buddhism in Houseki no Kuni. The entire video is loosely actually structured around this concept to begin with, just as the series itself is. And we don't really know until the end of the story how Ichikawa wants to fully address Buddhism as a religion within the context of this story. Even the video length gives nod to the significance of the number 108 in Buddhism, but not just in Buddhism. Fibonacci said that the number has a way of representing the wholeness of existence, and the sequence is tied to the golden ratio, like the spiral arrangement of leaves, of Phos. The distance between the Earth and Sun is 108 meters of the diameter of the Sun, and I guess in our story this is relating to the Moon where Enma stays. But if we look at the numbers individually, 1, 0, 8, 1 represents authority and leadership, as there's one creature, like Congo, in each of the races. There's one king for the snails, there is one prince for the Lunarians. 0 represents both nothingness and eternity, which is exactly what Phos feels, as they are completely alone, even if they were previously combined with others throughout a small portion of their overall life. But what's interesting is if you tack on a 0 for 1, it creates more of them. Multiples stack up those numbers and numbers and numbers. We got as high as 10,000 in a certain given chunk. It creates this longevity to it, and that zeroness, that nothingness, doesn't really feel so nothing after all. Or maybe if enough time has passed, even that length of time becomes nothing. 8 is power and influence, and as stated with volume 8, this is where Phos takes a real stand and divides up the gems for their mission. 8, if flipped to their side, is also infinity, eternity, so it's tying to two zeros coming together, canceling each other out. Adding up the digits gives us 9, which if you exclude the little add card, is the number of sections in this video. However, only 7 have real substance behind them. Even if all of these amazing symbolisms and meanings behind the numbers, I only actually use this timestamp as a representation of this, as it isn't even 108 minutes that you've been sitting through. It's 68, modeled after the 1 hour and 8 minutes. 108 is also, if it's in EST, this is in the afternoon, is not actually 108, it's 1308. All of these is just, it's just a placeholder. Maybe there's no meanings behind my intentions at all. Maybe it's just a little flex. Unless we're 100%, no, 108% sure that each chapter of Houseki no Kuni is a heavenly desire that Phos has to give up to reach enlightenment, we can't say for certain. I honestly wouldn't be shocked if Ichikawa only took us to chapter 107, but this points to a clear issue with Enma's plan. Phos, even in their eternal looking form, is not enlightened. They are most likely flawed in some way that the prayer will not go perfectly, because they are simply fabricated by the pieces of humanity just as broken Enma was. The duality of the machine and person are very prevalent in the eyes of Enma, and Enma does not treat Congo as a human. Every time he mentions Congo as a machine, it points to a function that Congo needs to do, like to pray, while Enma refers to Congo as Congo when it is about Congo themselves, like when Phos keeps their hands in a prayer position. This is really subtle, but the motions that Congo goes through for the routine to pray is actually different from the act of praying itself, and we see that with Phos in chapter 98. That light and the thought of prayer is a machine's role, while the physical movement is a conscious effort by our teacher, Congo. So when Phos actually says, "Damn machine, pray for me," it goes hand in hand, because Phos does not actually care for the person who is Congo, but only for the function that the machine can do to end Phos's long suffering. And Phos even now is treating it the same way with chapter 98, that this prayer, this thing that everybody wants, is the end all be all. It's not something that Phos actually wants, it's the inevitability that's to happen. And that's why it will most likely fail. Obviously, if chapter 99, which is going to come out in about a month at this point of time, it's September of 2022, I could be completely wrong, and that's okay. I don't think I've gotten a single thing right post hiatus. Anyways, another instance of this kind of suffering is when Enma confirms that Congo is broken, but the machine cannot control its power. Both Congo and the machine are broken, but they're two separate things. Even Congo, which is a artificially created being from the dreads of humans, it still counts as being human, because they think like humans, they act like humans, they respond like humans. With the restrictions, it's a lot harder. Congo is broken as a person, and the fact that he can't be with his makers and had to live a long life of nothingness under extremely high restrictions. Finding things that Congo loves caused Congo to be broken, because of the one function that Congo had as a machine is could not be prayed, because it would pray away everything that Congo loves and cherishes. Is this machine what is supposed to cause salvation in humans? Is Phos, the supposed potential god, supposed to cause the salvation in humans? If humans are really that terrible at taking care of what they create, what good is humanity even, and why does humanity deserve that kind of salvation? What's the point of having these kinds of feelings that makes us so evil, yet so kind at the same time, where we fight hard for our own people but massacre and slaughter those that we deem others? Phos sees Congo as not human and treats them differently, but is that just what a human would do outright anyways? An in-group in a social group is what a person psychologically identifies as being a part of a team, a part of a member of that unit. By contrast, an out-group is a social group in which that individual does not feel identified. This is what the psychology of a human dictates, that we create these biases and then let these biases influence our world. We're supposedly bound by objectivity, but the subjective takes on hard facts is where the nuance lies within us. Congo is given immense freedom at first, and it is ripped away when they went against humanity itself. Congo created a form of humanity with the gems because they need someone to free them of these shackles put down, and the doctor, which was shackled by the mortality of their body and whatever pain that was caused to them, could not find salvation in Congo, so they wait for the next iteration that gets closer and closer to what humanity is supposed to be like. Even the ideal form of humanity is still human at its core. Our brain is just like the inclusions that toss away the useless and only retain what is vital for the next day, because that is the only future we can look to because of its proximity to us. So looking back, why is Phos one of my favorite characters? I won't say exactly how high up, because of the 5,000 subscriber stream, which will be out in a few weeks, is where you'll need to guess my top 50 characters and prizes will be awarded, so you can decide how high Phos ranks in my top 50. Their struggle, their innocence, their ambition, their ego, their kindness, their pain, it's just like mine, just taken on in a completely different form. The physical manifestation of these scars on their being is taken to a breathtaking approach, and obviously I can't possibly ever do that with my whole body, but the changes were never intentional and just happens because it's the way of life. Do we really have control? Maybe. Is it okay to be ignorant? Maybe. Only you can decide how you want to live your life in the confines of your means. That is truly what it means to be alive. Whether you take the confidence that Phos has of their own self no matter what happens, or you fear your immortality due to a cinnabar in your life, or you're graced with generosity through the wealth of gold, or you study hard with the intellect of Lapis, attain self-respect through Pearl, care for others with Agite, or gain wisdom with Carnelian. Even without all these treasures, your body is your strongest and weakest asset, so please take care of it. All I really have left to say is thank you. Thank you for even deciding to click on this long-ass video, and thank you for continuing to watch, or maybe you skipped around through until the end. This would not have been possible without the following people: JPV, my forever roommate and artist, Raster, my producer, Sadakato, my lead editor, Penguin, the crystal editor, Mads, the silver editor, Splat, the gold editor, Capital M, the pearl editor, Fall, my graphic designer, and many others who show enthusiasm or excitement or support for whatever I make. It's really a blessing to be able to have this kind of audience. I could never have asked for anything different. Of the people that I've listed will be down in the description below to check out their own content if you're interested. I will link my second channel that is about YouTube that doesn't have any videos at the moment, but hey, maybe there will be some before the end of the year. Crap, am I missing anything? Let me know in the comments down below what your favorite part is, because I definitely rambled for a lot for this video to try to hit this mark, to hit that timestamp. But I'll see you all in October for chapter 99. Thank you, Haruko Ichikawa, for creating such a wonderful series that I get to review on. I'm gonna fill the rest of this time singing ED2 from the first season of the anime, Liquiamos.